Hello, I'm April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Sharon Wright Austin is a professor of political science at the University of Florida. Dr. Austin's teaching interests are in American government, urban politics, and African American politics. Her research interests are in African American mayoral elections, African American, Caribbean American political relationships, rural African American political activism, and African American political behavior. Dr. Austin joins me and my colleague, Dr. Sheila Harmon Martin, the division chair of the College of Arts and Sciences Division of Social and Behavioral Sciences and professor of political science. On this edition of Talking Arts and Sciences, we will discuss Dr. Sharon Wright Austin's new book, The Caribbeanization of Black Politics, Race, Group Consciousness, and Political Participation in America. Dr. Austin, welcome to Talking Arts and Sciences and the University of the District of Columbia. Dr. Martin, I want to thank you for your presence and bringing your expertise to this important topic.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Austin, this is an amazingly interesting and compelling subject. Mm-hmm. Before we really drill down on some of the questions about the work, can you talk a little bit about your process for approaching the topic?
The title of the book is The Caribbeanization of Black Politics, Race, Group Consciousness, and Political Participation in America. I conducted, over the course of about 7 years, several interviews, over 2,000 interviews in the cities of Boston, Chicago, Miami, and New York City. And I'm looking at the relationship between a concept in political science called group consciousness, which basically measures group solidarity, and whether or not when a group has group consciousness and group solidarity, whether it influences them to vote and to participate in other forms of politics. So that's pretty much just a general overview of the book.
So the book was published this year.
Earlier this year.
So tell me about what the reception has been and what you've been on the road some promoting the book and helping people understand. Mm-hmm. Tell me what the reception has been and what you're finding that you may want your next steps to be.
Mm-hmm. The reception has been very positive. I've given some presentations in Florida. I've given some presentations at bookstores. Yesterday I was at Howard University. Yesterday evening I was at a bookstore, Bus Boys and Poets, at 14th and V. And it's an honor to be here today giving this interview. The reception has been generally very positive. I think the book is something that scholars will want to read, teachers will want to read, but also just regular people will want to read. It's not a book that has such technical academic language that the average person can't understand it or can't read it. I think everyone will be educated by the findings of the book. Mm-hmm. And I also think that the book is very informative about the politics in the various cities that I look at. So the reception has been very positive.
When I think about Washington, D.C., where we sit, and I think about the diversity of the black community, and I'm using the word black purposely, the approach, the operationalization of the definitions and some of the findings apply here seamlessly. Have you thought about other cities that you're looking to actually apply a similar research frame?
As a matter of fact, I was looking at expanding. In the book, all of the people that I've interviewed were American citizens. And I was thinking of looking more specifically at black immigrants, because there's a big difference between people who are immigrants who aren't yet citizens and people who actually are citizens. And I was wanting to expand the framework to look at the political beliefs of people who have immigrated to this country but haven't become citizens yet. So that's one thing I'd like to do in the future. And I'd also like to expand not only the cities, but also the groups that I look at, because currently the book looks at African Americans, Cape Verdeans in Boston, Haitians and West Indians. So I wanted to look more specifically at other groups of Caribbean descent, and I also wanted to look at groups of African descent.
Okay. I was also wondering, in terms of what you defined as gateway cities, mm-hmm. and as the world is changing and is considerably more flat and the ways that people access geography mm-hmm. Have changed, can you talk a little bit more about what gateway might mean in a contemporary context or looking forward?
Right. In the cities that I look at, Boston, Chicago, Miami, and New York City, these are considered to be gateway cities in the sense that traditionally, especially New York City, has been a city where a lot of immigrants have traditionally mm-hmm. come to and settled, and that's been the first city in America where they've lived. And so that's why I selected each of them, because each of them have had demographic changes and more diversity within the Black community because of the influx of mostly Caribbean immigrants, but also of African immigrants. But the book only looks at Caribbean immigrants.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I want to drill down, and I'm going to hand over to Dr. Martin, who's our resident expert. Mm-hmm. But I do want to drill down on your research questions and use the discussion of the questions as a way to frame the work.
Right.
So I was particularly struck by your questions 2 and 5. Mm-hmm. And your question 2 asks, do African Americans and Black ethnics have a shared racial group consciousness in the four cities that you chose? Mm-hmm. And the 5th question was, will the growing populations of Black ethnics enhance Black political incorporation in these four cities?
Mm-hmm.
So you can kind of respond to what I'm asking you and talking about all of the questions if you like, but I think those 2 questions in particular, for me, mm-hmm. really did frame the work.
Right, yeah. Right. The second question looks at whether or not African Americans and Black ethnics have a shared group consciousness. In traditional political science literature, it's been found that African Americans at times vote at higher rates than whites, because of their group consciousness or because of their group solidarity. And they vote and they participate in politics in a way not only to benefit themselves as individuals, but to benefit their overall group. And so what I'm trying to determine in the book is whether or not other groups who are considered to be Black in American culture, Haitians, West Indians, Cape Verdeans, whether or not they also have a sense of solidarity. And if so, how that impacts or how that influences them to vote, mm-hmm. And then also does it influence them to participate in other political activities as well? And then the final question is sort of more so of an opinion question. In looking at, in the last chapter of the book, when I'm summarizing my main findings, looking at whether or not the cities of that I'm looking at will expand their Black political power because of the influx of Black ethnics, or whether or not these groups will compete with African Americans, and as a result, overall, the political power of Blacks just in general won't increase. So will there be coalitions or will there be competition?
Mm-hmm. And I think all of that's interesting in a framework mm-hmm. in terms of where our government now is in mm-hmm. terms of its views toward immigration.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So Dr. Martin, I'm going to hand over to you.
Dr. Austin, I was curious about your choice of the 4 cities. And of course in the readings it's largely because of the immigrant population. But first mm-hmm. of all, I want to ask you, why Black ethnics mm-hmm. versus Black immigrants?
Right. I use the term Black ethnics because all of the people that I interviewed are American citizens. Okay. Black immigrants are traditionally known as people who aren't citizens yet, and so mm-hmm. that's the difference mm-hmm. between the two. Mm-hmm. And when I use the term Black ethnics, I'm referring to Cape Verdeans, Haitians, and West Indians.
Okay, what were some of the similarities mm-hmm. and challenges you found in each city? Mm-hmm. Because there were some common themes among cities,
right.
but some real differences.
Right. I found, to my surprise, I found a lot more commonalities than differences. Mm-hmm. And I found that a lot of the literature that I've read over the years that predicted that there'd be a lot of divisions among the different groups, there are divisions, but despite those divisions, these groups are willing to work together. And so that was probably the main thing that I found that really surprised me.
Mm-hmm. So what are some of the challenges? Because in mm-hmm. some cities, there right. were some challenges.
Yeah, there were challenges in every city in the sense that as a political scientist who does research, who was trying to interview people, sometimes they didn't know who I was and they didn't understand what I was doing. Mm-hmm. So when I would go to places and when I would have this anonymous survey, I usually would try to make an arrangement with some type of group before I went, so that they would at least be familiar with who I was and what I was doing. And sometimes when I talked to people, it was obvious that they didn't want to fill out the survey because they were suspicious and they were hesitant, and they didn't quite understand who I was or why I was asking these questions. So that was the biggest challenge in every city.
Okay.
Can I jump in? So when you reached out to groups in the cities that would give you access,
right?
If the group embraced you and gave you access, did it give the participants a stronger sense of trust. Comfort and trust with you?
Right. With those particular group members, it did. But in some cases, when I would go to, and I would try to distribute the surveys in various public places, people just were very suspicious. And usually what I did was I would talk to people in the different organizations, and they would refer me to people that would be willing to fill out the surveys.
So how did you determine that an N of 2,000? Was it that you determined and really worked for an N of 2,000, or did it just evolve to be?
It just evolved into, I think the exact number is 2379.
Okay.
And I just just tried to do as many interviews as I could, because most of the literature of this type that looks at black immigrants and black ethnics only consists of just a few interviews. So I wanted to have a really comprehensive book, and I wanted to try to get as many interviews as I could.
Yeah, I personally think that it was really one of the most comprehensive studies looking at race consciousness among this group, and it really creates a good model for further research, which I'll ask you about some other groups later.
Okay.
But could you talk a little more specifically about each city? Like, for example, you point out how in some cities, black ethnics were successful in what you would identify as political incorporation.
Right.
And whereas in others, they were not as successful. Mm-hmm. And of course, in one particular city, there was some conflict between African Americans and black ethnics over a specific congressional election.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, in some cities, there were more successes, and a lot of that was based on the population. Mm-hmm. For example, in municipalities in Miami and near Miami-Dade County, for example, in North Miami and also in another community called El Portal, there is a large Haitian population. And as a result, there have been a number of Haitian Americans elected to political offices. Before 2000, there had never been a Haitian American elected anywhere in the city of Miami or in Miami-Dade County. But since then, at one time, North Miami had a predominantly Haitian city council. Mm-hmm. At one time, they had a Haitian American mayor. And so in that particular city, they were able to gain a lot of political power. But in Miami-Dade County, just in general, as I point out in the book, Haitian Americans and also just West Indians in general have not been able to really amass a lot of countywide political power. And a lot of that is because of the governmental system and the way things are set up. Mm-hmm. So in some cities, black ethnics have been more successful, but in other cities, for example, in New York City, a lot of the elected officials that I interviewed said that they felt that African Americans didn't really want people of Caribbean descent to be successful in politics because they sort of saw them as being somewhat of a threat. So.
Could you speak specifically a little more about Boston? Because I thought Boston was an interesting case study, and even Chicago in terms of the Haitian population. I learned some new information in terms of the size of Haitian population in Chicago.
In Chicago, or in Evanston, Illinois, there's a pretty sizable Haitian population, but the Haitian population in the Chicago area is smaller than that in the other cities that I look at. In Boston, in particular, the Haitian community is pretty sizable, and as a result, Haitian candidates have won in the Boston area. And I even mentioned a couple of women in particular who've been very successful in putting together not only coalitions in the black community between African Americans and black ethnics, but also just multiracial coalitions in general. And then also, even in situations in which Haitian Americans have not won elective offices, the Haitian American voters have shown the power of their vote because they've shown that they are a really viable constituency in those two cities. I guess the little bit of political science research that has been done on Haitians has mostly looked at New York City, and I guess to a lesser extent to Miami. So the findings on Boston and also in Chicago are very significant.
Yeah, yeah.
Those are two cities that haven't been explored very often.
Mm-hmm. So based on your findings, what do you think are some of the implications the Caribbeanization of Black mm-hmm. politics mm-hmm. in terms of, you know, future elections or some recent elections?
Right. I think it's very positive in the sense that there are a number of Caribbean immigrants who are continuing to come into American cities. I looked at four larger cities, but even if you look at some smaller cities, especially in the South, you're mm-hmm. seeing an influx of Black immigrants moving in. And they're, after they become citizens, they've been voting and they've been running for office. And it dispels a lot of stereotypes that say that immigrants who are from other countries come to America and they don't really have an interest in American politics, and that is not true. And in particular, people have always assumed that Black immigrants or Black naturalized citizens have not really wanted to vote. They don't really have very much of an interest in politics, and that is certainly not true mm-hmm. based on the interviews that I conducted and based on the activities in the cities.
Mm-hmm. You know, a contemporary kind of push toward assimilationism, mm-hmm. what impact could that potentially have on the bloc? So if you think about the Black ethnics voting as a bloc, mm-hmm. But we see that contemporary culture really is pushing at all of us to be not a thing, but being a, you know, just belong.
Right.
So how do you think that there are, what are the potential implications for, mm-hmm. yeah.
Well, when you think about assimilation, it's difficult even to use that term in the sense that, you know, you want people to come to America and to adapt, right. Right. But you also want, you don't want people to think that when they come to America, they have to give up their culture. Mm-hmm. Because one of the questions that I asked all of the people that I interviewed is, what is your racial identity? How do you identify? Mm-hmm. Or in other words, do you identify as being Black? And overwhelmingly, most of the people that I interviewed said that they consider themselves to be Black. But the Black ethnics also pointed out that despite the fact that I'm Black because of my skin color, I'm also very proud of my heritage. I'm mm-hmm. proud of my Haitian heritage or my Jamaican heritage. And so when we talk about assimilation, we want people to adapt into our culture so that they can become acclimated into our culture and they mm-hmm. can participate in politics. But we don't want them to think that that means that they have to give up their native heritage. Mm-hmm.
What was the age range for, the mean age for your groups by city? Do you know?
I would say, well, they range from the youngest person being 18 to, okay. I guess, the oldest person being in their 70s. I would say the average age range was probably in the 30s and 40s.
Did you see differences in identification by age or gender?
Yeah. I saw generational differences. Okay. I didn't really see mm-hmm. differences along gender lines,
okay.
but I did see a lot of generational differences in the sense that second generation and third generation Black ethnics who've been in this country longer, or in other words, who had parents or grandparents who had become mm-hmm. citizens and who had been around African Americans, who lived around them, gone to school with them, they first of all tended to vote at higher rates. And they also tended to not really hold on to as many negative stereotypes mm-hmm. about African Americans as members of the first generation.
Okay.
So people who had been in this country, who had been around African Americans, didn't really have the same types of stereotypes as their parents and grandparents.
Was their ethnic group affinity as strong?
As far as the younger people?
Yeah.
I would say probably not. I don't think they were as, I won't say that they were as committed to their group, but as far as their ethnic affinity, I think with the first generation, it was probably stronger, but the second and third generations were more politically active.
Okay.
You've talked a lot about linked fate mm-hmm. as one of the areas mm-hmm. that you looked at.
Right.
Would you kind of discuss that? Because I thought that was an interesting variable.
Okay, mm-hmm. that's something in political science research. It's a theory that's called linked fate. Professor Michael Dawson of the University mm-hmm. of Chicago has studied that extensively. And the definition of it is that one's fate is linked to one's race. So, mm-hmm. Or in other words, African Americans are thought to participate in politics and to vote in a way that benefits themselves as individuals, but also benefits the group, because they think that all Black people have sort of a linked or common type of fate. So mm-hmm. that's basically what that means.
Okay, okay. And so you pointed out that many of the Black ethnics have a linked fate with African Americans.
Right.
And you pointed out because of the perception of discrimination, and really indicating in their interviews that they had been discriminated right. against because
right.
they are black.
Right.
And you identified some other ways that they felt this linked fate.
Right, yeah. So in other words, they had a linked fate, not only with African Americans, but with the other members of their ethnic group, mm-hmm. in the sense that they felt that they had a lot in common with them because of their skin color, and also mm-hmm. because of their common experiences with discrimination.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, I thought that was a very good. So I wanted to also talk about some future implications of your research.
Mm-hmm.
And especially, we had a brief conversation about how the black ethnic population of other groups are really growing. Like, for example, in this area,
mm-hmm.
we have a lot of Nigerian Americans are groups from the continent.
Mm-hmm.
We also, for example, in Minnesota, you know, you have a lot of the Sudanese, and you have a black woman who's running for Congress, I think. She's running for Keith Ellis' position.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And so throughout the country, we have these black ethnics, mm-hmm. because obviously they're voting and running for mm-hmm. office, they're no longer can be just classified as black yeah. immigrants.
Right, right.
So what do you see is the implication for mm-hmm. this, not just in black politics, but nationally,
mm-hmm.
In terms of the whole diversity of some of our, the potential diversity of some of our institutions,
mm-hmm.
and mm-hmm. unfortunately some of the backlash that we're experiencing
right.
now within the political environment.
Right, I think that you're going to see in the future more people who are black ethnic running for office and winning office as their populations increase. And then also, I think you're going to see more multiracial coalitions, younger politicians. As a matter of fact, you're seeing a lot of young progressives who are African American and who are black ethnic, who are running for Congress, who are running for governor of various states. For example, even in Florida, there's an African American man, Andrew Gillum, who the polls are showing has a very good chance of being our first black governor there.
Mm-hmm,
so you're seeing these young black progressives and black ethnic progressives who are putting together these multiracial coalitions.
Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of them were very much influenced by President Obama mm-hmm. and what he was able to accomplish in getting elected and reelected as president. And it's encouraging that you have more diversity in the black community, and you have more people who traditionally have not really been known as people who've been involved in politics, getting involved and being successful. But everyone in the African American community isn't embracing this
mm-hmm.
because there
mm-hmm.
are some people who see this as sort of a threat. And one of the things that I point out in the book is that in each of these cities, African Americans have struggled with mixed successes for political power.
Mm-hmm.
And now, in some cases, they're seeing these people coming in, and they feel that these people are taking what rightfully is ours.
Mm-hmm.
We should be the people getting elected. But instead of us, we've got this person who's Jamaican or Haitian, and sometimes those people have totally different views.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're seeing those divisions. So it again shows that there's a lot of diversity in the
yeah.
black community. We don't all think alike.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So what's the work to be done that actually allows groups to identify the commonality mm-hmm. and to even leverage the possibilities of difference?
One of the things that I noticed in every city, and one of the comments that I've received consistently when I was looking at the anonymous surveys, is that a lot of people who are African American and black ethnic didn't feel like political organizations were doing enough to mobilize them. So these are people who vote at in high numbers, but they feel that the political organizations and also the major political parties aren't reaching out to them as they should to mobilize them. So in the future, I think that for candidates who are running for office, that's something that they need to keep in mind, that there is a large constituency out there that wants to vote for you, but in many cases I interview people and they didn't know who their representatives
mm-hmm.
were.
Mm-hmm.
So those are people who are almost just waiting to be mobilized.
Mm-hmm. And that has implications for the political parties, you know,
mm-hmm.
especially since, for example, the Democratic Party is supposed to be a big tent, but
uh-huh.
if they're not looking at this potential
right.
core group of the bloc, and even the Republican Party, you know, I mean, the
yes,
you
definitely.
Know, traditional Republican Party, you know, the autopsy talked about creating a big tent.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it could presently attract a lot of black ethnics, but there's future implications
right.
if they really look at these groups.
Right, there definitely is a possibility.
Mm-hmm. You know, I read a more recent article of yours that introduced issues around Afro-Latinos. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was just very interesting because the dynamics are very different.
Right.
Could you just bring, I know it's not part of this book, but I saw it as really intriguing right. analysis and mm-hmm. probably your future research.
Right. I just published a book chapter of this, getting ready to come out in a book on urban politics that talks about Dominican politics in New York City. Mm-hmm. And New York City is one of the cities that I cover in this book also. And I also recently wrote, the article I think you're referring to is in the National Political Science Review, mm-hmm. and that article also looked at, I guess, Dominicans in New mm-hmm. York City. When I was doing the research for this book, I interviewed Dominicans in each of the four cities, and I also interviewed Afro-Cubans in Miami, mm-hmm. and that was a chapter that I wanted to include in this book as a chapter that looked at the same questions that I asked the African-Americans and the black ethnics. If I ask Afro-Latinos those same questions, people who identify primarily as Hispanic, even mm-hmm. though they have brown skin, mm-hmm. would their views have been different? And that was something at first that I had in the book, but that the anonymous reviewers said that they felt that it didn't really fit in mm-hmm. as well as the other chapters, so I removed it. So it is something that I'd like to look at in the future.
Okay, yeah, because I noticed you talked about the Cubans, but you know, we have a growing Afro-Brazilian population mm-hmm. In the United States, and
right.
of course, a core of Afro-Puerto Ricans.
Right, Afro-Puerto Ricans in particular,
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
So where do you want the work to go? Beyond now.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to, in the future, continue as the populations grow of the groups that I study, to continue to look at the framework and to ask those same questions, maybe 5 years from now with a different mm-hmm. generation mm-hmm. of voters, and see if there are any differences or similarities. And also would like to expand the number of groups, because as we mentioned, Afro-Latinos, and then expand the number of people that I consider to be black ethnic, and then also I'd like to expand the number of cities, mm-hmm. and not just look at the larger urban cities, but even look at smaller communities that have been transformed by immigrants.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of activism and organizing on a community level, mm-hmm. what's been the response, or how are people able to access and actually apply?
Well, can you say that one more time?
Yeah. So as you've traveled the country mm-hmm. and the book has been met with real excitement, and but how are people at the community level of organizing and activism able mm-hmm. to access the information and actually apply it mm-hmm. to benefit their communities? Are you getting feedback on kind of on the ground organizing and
okay.
activism?
So far I haven't really, because I've only been to some places in Florida and then also to D.C. I haven't really been able to travel as much as I would like to promote the book, and that's something that I'm planning to continue doing next year. The book was just published just a few months ago, so I haven't really gotten a chance to really talk to very many community activists to get their reaction to the book, mm-hmm. But that is something I'd like to do in the future, and so, I mean, that's just something to think about doing in the future.
So we're out of time, but
okay.
I do want to thank you so much. This is an amazingly interesting and important, very timely topic.
Thank you.
So I want to thank you, Dr. Austin. I want to thank you, Dr. Martin. And to my audience, if you would like to learn more about the University of the District of Columbia College of Arts and Sciences, please visit us at www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Your dream, our guidance.